Welcome back. Imagine this. You set out for your well-earned holiday on a pristine Pacific island, only to find that thousands of unexploded bombs litter the area, threatening the lives of both holidaymakers and locals. Enter a husband and wife team, backed by their dedicated staff, determined to rid the island of this deadly legacy. Here's David Brill.
Beautiful Palau and its string of tropical islands is a magnet for tourists. But this sparkling holiday destination hides a bloody history.
In the Southwest Pacific, 500 miles from the Philippines, are the Palaus. On a tiny one called Peleliu, the Japs have a good airstrip. We must seize it to protect our invasion of the Philippines. We begin by softening it up. Bombing.
A ferocious World War II battle has begun.
The airstrip is straight ahead.
The Japanese have fortified this strategic island and will fight to the death.
Jap mortar and artillery fire is heavy. Many landing vehicles are knocked out, but we're on the beach.
This is one of the famous landing beaches on the 15th of September 1944. The Americans swept in from out here on the reef. On the promontory just down here, they hadn't realised there was a huge bunker, so they were directly in the firing line as they landed.
Cassandra McEwen is from Cleared Ground, a not-for-profit demining organisation. She knows this area and its terrible history well.
Casualties the first day, 92 killed, 1,100 wounded, 58 missing. 15 million rifle and machine gun bullets, 90,000 mortar shells, 150,000 field artillery shells, and 125,000 hand grenades will be presented by the Marine Corps to Imperial Japan.
See, just over there in the mangrove, there's actually probably a 100-kilogram bomb that's sticking out of the mangrove itself.
Steve Ballinger is also with Cleared Ground. They're here to clean up a legacy that's remained for 70 years, and he's a demining expert.
But this one here, got a little crab on it. Now, this looks like it's been opened, and either the high explosive has been removed or it's leaked out, one of the two.
God.
And then over on the far side, it won't quite reach, but you can see there's a hexagonal nut. That is a sea mine. So we're only looking in an area about 20 foot by 20 foot, and already we've got five items of ordnance.
Seems to me, Steve, that people ring up and they say they found one. You get out here, you end up finding a lot more.
Yeah, that's quite often the case, actually, is, you know, obviously people are concerned. They've seen an item, and then we come out here and do a thorough check and generally walk away with an awful lot more. What I've actually identified already is, now the tide's going out, we've got three Japanese sea mines and four aircraft bombs that are all laying on the edge of the mangrove. All right. Any questions?
You're good, kid.
Yeah.
Steve and his team have been working here for 4 years. They've removed 23,000 explosives.
After being coming from here and doing this now, surprised how many ordnances are left around?
Yeah, I'm very surprised. Growing up, of course, we see them laying around, but you never know that they're this big and there's so many of them around.
All right, Riley, well, good luck.
Thank you. Hopefully, there will be no red mist when you guys come back.
It's dangerous, heavy work, carried out in extremely hot and humid conditions.
And more than anything, we're starting to realize the danger, the extent of the danger, not only to the people, but to the environment.
Governor Leilani Rekle says the rusting relics threaten not only the locals, but the economy as well. Palau's tropical islands and spectacular diving lure tourists from all over the world.
Tourism being, as you can see, being our main industry, the only industry that's bringing in new dollars into the economy, a lot of these ordinance are in the areas where the visitors are going to.
And if something happened.
And something happens, you know.
Destroy the industry.
Would really, absolutely.
And for the governor, the issue is personal.
People getting, you know, their limbs blown off or, you know, dying altogether or, you know. My grandfather had his both of his hands blown off from the activity. I guess they knew some of them were still alive, but they tried to disassemble them and
boom.
And boom, yeah.
And here's the environmental problem the governor mentioned.
What's all that stuff, that grease?
That's picric acid.
That's acid, is it?
Yeah.
Wow. This is all poison acids going into the rivers, eh?
Mm-hmm.
Not good.
Not good at all.
So you got four of them this morning?
Four here. We just got another report that there's two more down in that area.
Wow.
So we're gonna go get those two.
Today?
Yeah.
Right. Never ends.
Never ends. Picric acid inside is what, even after all these years, it's still active, so. Still wanna get rid of them. And that's the main thing that's destroying the mangrove areas here.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of mangrove crabs, food that the local people eat here.
As the team is retrieving this massive bomb, they receive a call from this area.
Where did you find it?
Right there,
right.
Next to that tree.
So this is it here, right?
Yeah.
And this is your son?
Yeah, this is my son, Truman.
Does it worry you that he's running around here with these bombs?
Yeah.
Does it worries you?
Yeah, it worries me, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because there's a lot of people, you know, burning trash and stuff, and I don't want to get it exploded, and my son is still too young to get exposed to chemicals and stuff from it.
Yes.
Yeah.
No sooner have we left this house than we're called to a neighbour's place, where Steve's team has been busy.
Tell me about this stuff around here.
Well,
please.
This is American hand grenade.
American hand grenade, yes.
Any mortar 16mm.
That's a mortar.
I'm sorry, mortar.
Right. And where did you get this stuff from?
This house at the backyard.
Near this house?
Yeah.
On this occasion, the bomb awareness message doesn't seem to have got through.
You worried about them?
No.
Hmm. Why not? What do you think, Steve?
Well, I'd be pretty worried. Contain high explosive. I'd be pretty worried about it myself. What we'll do is I'll leave a couple of guys here to secure the arms, and we're finished. We'll get the arms taken away.
And it's not just the land that's being cleared. The team works underwater. A very complex job.
Basically, they've attached the lift bag.
That's a yellow bag.
A big yellow. It's an underwater recovery system.
Yes.
So that is attached to the 1,000-pound bomb.
The company has a policy to employ and train locals. These men will be able to work in the dive industry when the clearance project is finished. And now there's one less bomb for Palauans to worry about. When enough ordnance has been collected, it's very carefully prepared. And then detonated from a safe distance.
Stand by! Firing! Now!
Just
wait.
As well as the mine clearance, there's another reason for coming. I want to learn about a famous Australian who died here. Damien Parra was a young combat cinematographer whose work and dedication I greatly respect.
What happened was they first tried to take the promontory, but they only had one tank.
Para was killed 3 days into the battle as the troops pushed forward.
Tanks came down this way across this little isthmus and they were aiming towards this island here. And Damien was behind the very first tank.
In this area generally where he was killed?
Yes, practically here.
He would have had a wonderful life, I think, career. He's very talented.
From here, the battle raged up the hill.
That's Bloody Nose Ridge in the background, 1,000 yards away. Up there, the Jap is heavily entrenched in a honeycomb of caves and fortified positions. That's where he'll make his final stand.
If anything, here the fighting became even more intense.
There's a Jap.
The enemy was blasted and burnt out of the caves. Like 70 years ago, the caves are still very hard to see.
We've got a steep here.
And I can't imagine how the soldiers fought their way up here.
So, Steve?
Getting into the caves is even more difficult.
Right.
Okay, so the first thing we come across here is an American, American Marine helmet, and the artifacts are very important just so we can establish who was in the caves and create a sort of historical document, not just a clearance document, but a historical document.
Right, what else we got here?
Well, directly down here in front of me here, we have human remains. They're marked.
Can you pick that up?
We tend not to disturb the human remains. We then have to obviously do a human remains report that goes off to the president of Palau's office, and then anthropologists come and tests are conducted to establish if they're American or Japanese or in fact Palauan remains of what has been found in some of the caves as well.
Right.
And there's reason to move very carefully in here.
Yeah, so these are incendiary grenades as well. Now, some have the pins in, as we can see, others have corroded away.
Could they be quite dangerous if you played around with them too much?
Yeah, it'd be extremely dangerous. So when we're clearing the caves, when the clearance is taking place, it's one man, one risk.
What do you mean by that?
Well,
one man, one risk.
So we only ever have one person in the cave at any one time whilst they're conducting clearance. We can't really proceed any further, but as you can see, as you pan across, you can see numerous hand grenades, and our clearance deminer has come across three here which had their safety pins still in.
Oh, the red ones there.
Yeah, so what he's done is he's gagged the grenade so the safety pin can't come out.
So, Steve, it's very hot in here.
Yeah.
You imagine the soldiers living here and working here, let alone seeing your colleagues now trying to get rid of all this stuff.
Yeah, pretty difficult task.
Very difficult task.
I was relieved to get back out in the fresh air.
Is it important for you to clear these caves?
Yeah, it is, because, you know, Palau has a lot of tourism, and a percentage of that tourism is World War II history tourism. And people want to see what the fighting and living conditions were.
The echoes of battle are everywhere here. The old Japanese headquarters struggles to hold back the jungle. It's easy to imagine the frantic activity here as the Americans closed in for the kill. The monuments bear witness to the fallen.
From a tree-covered stronghold, Bloody Nose Ridge has been reduced to a scarred heap of rubble strewn with Jap dead, over 10,000 of them. And we have what we came after, the airstrip.
Cash, this is the strip that the fighting is supposedly all over.
That's right, this is what it was all about. This is 1,800 yards. This is the landing beaches over here. Yeah. And they swept across and then you've got the ridge over here, so.
As we drove, I couldn't help thinking about all those who died from both sides for these 1,800 yards.
Some of these Marines were on Peleliu for only a few hours. Some will remain forever.
It was a long time ago, but at last the legacy of that fateful battle is being addressed.
David Brill sweating it out in Palau. David tells us that Cassandra McEwen was once a trader on the London Stock Exchange. She swapped her Gucci handbag and pinstripe suit for khakis and humanitarian work because she thought there was more to life than making big profits for big banks. And who's paying for the Palau clear-up? Well, the Australian government has put over $4 million into the project. You can find out more on our website.